Hi, and welcome back to NYthespirit.com and our video channel. Well, we heard part one of our fantastic times with Ivar Hamilton. Settle in now, because here it comes, part two. Ivar, good to be back with you.
Good to be back too.
So we reached the point where you were at CFNY, and I have the greatest and utmost respect for David Pritchard and Lee Eckley and all the people who were there before I arrived. I really do have the utmost respect for them. There are a lot of people who thought I had them fired, which is just not true.
Right, right.
However, I arrived on the scene. I walked in the building the first day, and I thought, what on earth is this? It was dirty, it was messy, and something made me stay. The only thing, one more story about NY that I think is worth everyone hearing. Mm-hmm. Is about the day you came into my little corner office, and I was sitting on one of those three-legged chairs, and I was sitting behind a desk that was filthy, and we were in receivership because the Allen brothers had lost the stations, and there was no money for anybody, and there was nothing we could do about it.
Yep.
And if something broke, we had to fix it with scotch tape. Mm-hmm. And you said, I'd kind of like to find a way to make some money. Because I've got to eat. This is a true story. And then you said, I was thinking maybe I could do some record hops. And I think you might have even used that 1950s lingo.
No, I don't think I used the lingo, but I said, this is again an influence from my time in the UK, because they used to, in the UK, it was like they got out, they had radio stations to get out and do road shows, and that hadn't been used here. So you'd see what's the Radio 1 road show, or it's the Capital Radio road show, and I was like, I'd like to call it a road show. Let's get out there and do this. And it really was that I had no money, and I'm like, I needed to pay the bills. I think I just moved out of the house for the first time, and it's like, well, you were very good about it, because I remember the discussion was, well, you can go out and do it, you can use the station name, but we need to take a percentage of that, which was fine. And it also became a way for our DJs to make extra money, too, because none of us were making it, and none of the DJs were making any money either. And, it went from being a very small setup to being a full-on production and five-ton truck and, rivaling most bands out there. And we made lots of mistakes back in the day. I mean, I think the first one that I learned was electricity. And it was like we'd go to these high schools with our big show, and it's like, well, we need X amount of power. And some kid that we talked to would bring an extension cord from home that didn't quite cut it. So we had to scramble a number of times. And the second thing was about, the things that we did outside of schools. It was getting paid, because we got stiffed a number of times too. But it was a great experience, and I think it was, to me, one of the best ways we ever had to meet people, our listeners. And I would say that it was a great market research of the 80s, because I also remember coming back many times going, we come back from these schools and go, by the way, the kids are asking for a bunch of these bands that we're not playing, i.e. the Violent Femmes and Skinny Puppy and Beastie Boys. We should start playing these bands. So it was great feedback and market research for that end of things.
Now it turned, the CFNY video roadshow, it became eventually turned into a huge and most wonderful promotion, but also, as you say, a great way to communicate one-on-one with the people who
absolutely
listen to us.
I suppose one of the things that, and I don't really have had too many experiences since that, is we did shows at Ontario Place for a couple of years. And the first year, it was, it was okay, it wasn't bad, reasonable crowds, we had a good time, and it was like, I remember saying, okay, we're back for the second year, and we're going to be at a little bit different location. So I remember going back, the second year, and we were sponsored by Alberto Balsam Moose was our sponsor. And they had a moat around the stage. So the first show was like, okay, there's a few more people here than last time. And by about the third show, we were doing like 4,000 and 5,000 people all the way up. I remember shows that were like 7,000, 8,000 people. We didn't have enough sound. And it was like, so we'd throw all the, the moose out as prizes, and the people would just absolutely bob one another with this moose, and the whole moat was filled up with foam all over the place. And, and of course, right at the end of that year, I remember our sales guy coming in and he goes, it went really well. As a matter of fact, it went too well. They've decided not to do it anymore because they can't handle the crowd. So it was a great testament to, you know, what we were doing that year. It just seemed that that year that we did it, and I think it was 85, maybe 86, that it seemed like every kid in the city of Toronto was out for summer holidays at every, whatever it was, mm-hmm. Wednesday night, we're going to the road show mm-hmm. at Ontario Place. Mm-hmm.
You see, the interesting thing about that is there are two people who I know. One of them is the accountant, actually, for NYthespirit.com, the other is yourself.
Right, right.
And between the two of you, and I don't think you've ever met each other, mm-hmm. between the two of you, there is not a single concert, large or small, that either of you ever miss.
Oh, right.
You're at every single thing, still, even now.
Well, I don't go to as many as I used to. I pick and choose more, but, you know, it was true back in those days. If you talk about the music, I mean, I took it upon myself to go and see just about everything and anything and everything. You know, and I was very fortunate to see things that nobody else got to see. You know, whether that be, you know, the U2's first appearance at the Alma Combo, and there was 80 people there. There mm-hmm. was nobody at that show. You know, I went to see Bob Marley. I went by myself. I went to the Stones did the thing out in Oshawa, the concert for the blind. I was at that. I went, you know, first show from Duran Duran, first show from Echo and the Bunnymen, first show from Susie, first show from 999. I mean, I went to everything.
Do you remember Edgerton's over on Girard?
Great story about that place.
Yes.
So Gary Topp, you know, he used to call the radio station all the time, and he was always like, you know, hey, can you plug this a little bit? Can you mm-hmm. say, Gary, you know, I love Gary. We got along mm-hmm. great. And and Cormier, too. These are the two Garys. It was actually Cormier called me, and he knew that we never had two sticks to rub together financially. So my other good friend at the station, who I'm still good friends with, is Kevin O'Leary, and Cormier calls me up, and he goes, I know that you and O'Leary don't have any money. He goes, so it's okay if you guys want to bring a case of beer down to the shows, that's okay, right? And I'm like, really? So there we were, you know, like they'd let us sneak a case of beer and then we'd be able to.
This is at Edgerton?
At the Edgerton Club.
That's funny.
And he was just, you know, he knew we were young guys that didn't have any money. So, we'd get into the show and we could bring a couple of beers in if we wanted, you know.
Cormier was a magnificent guy. Still is.
Cormier really is. They both are, you know. And, you know, great experiences at the Edge Club. I mean, you know, Larry's Hideaway, you know, I did my first sort of outside the road show DJ stint there. It was like, you know, whatever it was, punk rock jock or new wave Mondays or whatever it was. And, you know, all the hookers would come down and have a great time. And it's true though. In there one night, and there was some girl, and I was dancing with the dance floor. And goes, if you want to get any further, you're going to have to pay for that. And I was like, really? But, you know, we did some amazing things that, you know, with the Thursday Night Live series at Larry's Hideaway. I mean, there was many bands that we did. I distinctly remember you telling me, you said, we should record this band that I think is going to go somewhere. They're called REM. And I'm like, okay, we'll get on it.
So I know you always went to concerts back in the day.
Yeah.
But you still go.
I still do.
What's the latest thing you've seen?
Well, I went to see J.D. McPherson last week. Mm-hmm. Did a show at Lee's Palace. And for me, it was the best show I've seen this year. And I think that, you know, with J.D. McPherson, the music's not new. It's very retro. It's almost if the Stray Cats were starting again in 2015, it might be J.D. McPherson without the rockabilly look, but the feel of it was just authentic and real. It was like, it's, you know, real rock and roll from Oklahoma. I just loved it. Thought mm-hmm. it was absolutely fantastic. I saw this band from Scotland last weekend. They're called the Temperance Movement. Band is really supported by the Classic Rock magazine in the last couple of years, just starting here. But they really kick. Like, you tell these guys have probably played 1,000 gigs, but just starting in Canada, starting mm-hmm. all over again. Mm-hmm. But to me, that was a band that I'm like, you know, I think that people are going to pick up on this. I don't know if it's necessarily, you know, an alternative crowd, but a great meat and potatoes rock and roll band. And I still love all kinds of, there's all kinds of music that I love beyond what, you know, what we do at NY The Spirit, although you probably hear me going pretty wide on things that, you know, whether that be, you know, a reggae or soul or African or a little bit of metal or, and of course, you know, punk and what have you, you know.
So. But see, that's the magic. The magic for me about NYthespirit.com is the same magic that we had back at Chum FM, the same magic when it was a free form, magic we had at CFNY.
Yeah.
And that is that people who know something about music play it and talk about it.
Yes, and I think that's important. It's important and important to me. I always think that, you know, great to have people, you know, hear some things that they haven't heard for a long, long time. I think, you know, to me, it's always great when you find something, oh, I played that way back when, I haven't heard that for a long time, because that really gets you going. But for me, it's always been part of my thing is to turn people on to things that they haven't necessarily heard before and that I hope that they'll like too. It's like, you know, and I know that not everything they'll like, and some things will go, what in the world is he doing? But for the most part, I just, it's important to me. So, you know what, here's some things that I think people would like to hear, you know, so.
Well, you know, I mean, you're in a position now to hear music and to be aware of music, as you have been since you were 18, 14, 15,
sure.
12,
sure.
11, 8 yeah. years yeah. old, listening
yeah.
to whatever.
Yeah.
You've never swerved from that. You've always stayed on the road.
Yeah, I mean, I think it's one of those things. I mean, you know, in my professional life, I'm, you know, still in the business, but I also, you know, collecting music and buying music is, and learning about it has always been a thing for me. I still buy, you know, back in the day, I'd buy a Melody Maker and a NME, but now I would buy a, you know, Record Collector and Mojo and Uncut and Classic Rock magazine and look at a bunch of other things. And now, of course, now everybody can listen to music if they, you know, spend a little bit of money and go on to a service, you know, one of the streaming services. You can go and listen to anything that's out there, you know, and get a feel for it. I think for us at NY The Spirit, we take the best of that, or what we think is the best of, and we curate it and go, okay, well, we heard this and this out there, and check it out.
No, I absolutely agree. I mean, back in the day at CFNY, the folks at Selkirk came up with the name Trusted Editor.
Mm-hmm.
Now it's Curator.
Right.
I think Curator's kind of nice, except does it mean we're rattling around in a museum?
Well, it depends what you're curating, you know. I mean, I'm doing stuff. We do stuff all the time, you know, things that we do for, you know, on Spotify. And it depends on what they want, you know. It's like, hey, we're looking for New Music Tuesday. Well, you know, in fact, you could be putting together your compilation cassette or whatever back in the day. But now it's like, you know, the best of whatever new music. But, you know, I mean, I'll go in there and, you know, I'm working on a soul thing right now for them. And you know, that's lots of fun. I have a great affection for soul music of the 60s as well, and that's fun to me as well.
Tell me, soul, I never heard you use that word before, and I've known you a long time. give me an artist name that you think is really applicable to that category.
Well, I think that there's...
That you love.
Well, I think there's many. I mean, I think that, you know, you can take the stuff out of the Chess Records songbook, which is a bit of soul and blues and things out of Stax. So you kind of go Stax, Motown, Chess, take all of those ones and put it into there. And I think also, you know, some of the things that might have been out of the Northern Soul scene that would have influenced some of those 80s artists. So, you know, you get an artist like Soft Cell, that, you know, you take Tainted Love, that was a Gloria Jones song that was a Northern Soul dance floor filler that those guys would have heard in the 70s and took it to the 80s, and
that's particularly, you know, true of the UK.
But you'd say that, you know, you could have it, that's in you know, in that the soul scene influenced on Dexy's Midnight Runners, Soft Cell, ABC.
Even the biggies like the Stones were influenced.
Oh, absolutely. They all worked, you know, they went to, you know, Stones recorded at Muscle Shoals, they recorded at Chess Records, you know, they all love that, that whole situation, and you get a lot of those things. Paul Weller, you know, Paul Weller did a compilation with Cab DeBarge where they put their soul favorites and things like that. So it's not solely for a guy like me who likes to spin punk records and things like that. And maybe we'll take a show and spin you a bunch of soul favorites, you know?
You know, sometimes, yes, and I would love that. But sometimes I've been known to say that there is no bad music.
Right.
Except to the individual listening to it.
Sure, sure.
It's subjective. Yeah. We each make our own minds up what is good and what is bad.
Absolutely. And I must admit, you know, years ago, and you'll know this, that I was a terrible music snob. But I admit that
freely. Do you think?
But, you know, as time goes on, it's like, you know, to me, it's like, you know, people, you can like what you like. It's fine by me.
And everything has a place.
Yes.
Ivar Hamilton, of course, has a wonderful show here at NYthespirit.com. I know you've probably listened to it many times. I urge you to tell your friends about it, have them come on in. Because you're going to hear music and you're going to say, whoa, I'd forgotten all about that. That's the first song I got laid to. Thank you, Ivar
Hamilton. Thank you very much.
It's a pleasure. It's a pleasure to know you and a pleasure to work with you.
It's always a pleasure here, too, as well.
Thanks, everybody.
It's all over but the shouting. It's all done.